recent referendum regarding the exit of Britain from the European Union, the subject of secession has been brought to the forefront in the United States. This strategy has even been promoted by many in the libertarian and anarchist community. One example being Dave Ridley, a free stater, who started the New Hampshire Exit Project, or NH Exit for short. Other examples, I'm not sure if they're anarchists or libertarians or not, other examples of this trend include Vexit, which is Vermont, Texit, which is Texas, CalExit or California, which is California, and HawaiiExit, which is obviously Hawaii, and those are just the ones that I'm aware of. As refreshing as it is that there's actual discussion on strategy, I believe that there really hasn't been deep thought on the subject, and I feel some really deadly ramifications may have been overlooked, the most likely being the highly probable backlash from the federal government. For that reason, we'll cover as many angles as we can this evening. In the first three segments, we'll be joined by Gary Hunt from the Outpost of Freedom blog. You can find his blog at outpost-of-freedom.com/blog. He'll provide us with the history of secession, legal arguments against it, and also the potential ramifications if such action were to come into fruition. In the final segment, I will provide the philosophical arguments against secession from a proprietarian anarchist point of view. So without further ado, welcome back to Liberty Under Attack Radio, Gary. How are you doing this evening?
Okay,
there you are.
I guess it pushed the button hard enough. I'm doing fine, man. Shane. How are you doing?
Doing good. Can't complain. Thanks so much for coming on to discuss this very, very relevant subject this evening. So rather than we've had you on a couple of times, and I've read your biography, both of those, but rather than reading that, why don't you just give the listeners a brief introduction of who you are and what you do?
Well, I was a professional land surveyor for about 40 years, measuring the ground. Guy looks through the tube on the side of the road and you wonder what the hell he's doing. But ran at odds with the government about 1981, primarily over income taxes. And then I happened to go to Waco, Texas back in March of 1993 and have been writing for the Patriot community since then. The most recent the story that I've covered by going to the scene was Burns, Oregon, but I've been to many others in the last 23 years. And so I will continue as long as I can doing the same. And then I write historical works quite often, and thought-provoking works to Liberty or Law series, for example, looks at the law and wonders if it really means what the government says it means.
Okay. All right. Very, very good. So so we definitely got a lot to cover tonight. So let's go ahead and get on with it. So let's first touch on the history of secession in the United States. And I've got five brief examples that will only take a few minutes. And then I'll turn it over to you to cover the Civil War. First one is Cascadia, which the sentiment occurred in the 19th and 20th century in parts of Washington, Oregon, some other U.S. states, and British Columbia. The state of Jefferson was in 1941, southern Oregon and northern California. Second Vermont Republic, proposed in 2003 by former Duke University economics professor Thomas Naylor. Killington, Vermont, 2004 and 2005. Briefly, the citizens of the ski resort community wanted to secede from Vermont and gain admission into the state of New Hampshire, just 25 miles to the east. And the Republic of Lakota in 2007, proposed by a group of American Indians to form a new state at the borders of the 1851 Treaty of Fort Laramie between the U.S. government and Lakota, specifically North and South Dakota, Nebraska, Wyoming, and Montana. And what's interesting is that I've followed up on these, and it really doesn't look like any of them have come into fruition. It seems to be just a movement. But there's been no secession yet. I guess the only one, and we were talking about this in pre-show, Gary, was the state of Jefferson. Can you tell us a little about that and what progress they've made, if any?
Well, the original state of Jefferson in 1941, they had begun arming. We were actually preparing for secession, probably along the lines of the Civil War. How large the movement had grown by then is difficult to determined, but one of the stories about that was on one of the highways, U.S. Highway 99, they had set up a roadblock, and a California Highway Patrol officer was going up that way, and they stopped him and said, turn around and go back to California. But this was shortly before the beginning of World War II, and with the attack on Pearl Harbor, the state of Jefferson was pretty much abandoned. It's been kicked around a few times over the last at least 20 years. Right now, there's an effort. Now, the current effort is not to secede, it's to create new states. Rather than secession, and I'm not sure if the state of Jefferson in 1941 was to secede or to just secede from California, that portion, but it included other states, but Oregon, whether they wanted to create a new state of Jefferson, which is the image I get, but I'm not really sure about 1941, but that movement of seceding from states, but that would be consistent with Article 4, I think it's Section 2 of the Constitution, that the state to be created out of parts of one or two states, like West Virginia, has to be done with the consent of the legislature. So all they really needed, if they were seceding from California and Oregon, would be to get the Oregon legislature and the California legislature to grant them leave to leave. But I think that's the current effort, is going to be submitted or has been submitted to the California legislature. I'm not following it, though, unless it happens. I do live in what would be the state of Jefferson, and I would much rather be there than in the state of California.
Yeah, very good, very good. And see, that's an interesting distinction, too, because I was going to mention this, but there was something in Illinois a couple of years back, I think. And there was, I think, a couple senators or something put something into the House of Representatives or whatever to create a new state, and everything south of I-80 would become separate from Chicago, because, I mean, yeah, Chicago is a hellhole, and it doesn't represent, especially southern Illinois. So there was an attempt at that, never went anywhere, which I'm not really surprised, but that happened here in Illinois a couple few years back, and it's been tossed around, but nothing's ever came of it. But let's get into essentially your specialty, which is history. So there was obviously a lot of historical there are some historical examples in the Civil War of Secession. Can you run over those however long you need to?
The first one was in the early 1800s, the Hartford Convention. In promoting the convention, they had suggested the possibility of seceding from the Union. However, it was never discussed during the convention. But that is the first one. Now, that's the Yankees saying you have a right to secede. Then we moved to 1832, where South Carolina, because of tariffs, 1832, 28 years before then, because of tariffs, they wanted to secede, and they argued that it was extra constitutional. It was kind of interesting because Calhoun, I think it was, let me see, Calhoun had presented, I think, a fairly reasonable argument in favor of secession if the government didn't abide by the Constitution. And yeah, it was Calhoun. But he didn't argue the tariff in doing it. He just said if they violate the Constitution, that we have a right to secede because the Union is based upon obedience to the Constitution. Now, all the arguments against him and the reason the legislature rejected his resolution was they were arguing the tariff, which he had not argued, but everybody knew what the subject was. Now, pretty much the same issue, that and the division of states. Now, the Missouri Compromise for establishing, south of this line you can be a slave state, north of this line you can't, made sense because in the colder regions you're not going to find slaves willing to work. But the imbalance of non-slave states or free states versus slave states created a political disadvantage for the South, and which eventually, over tariffs and over the issue of prohibition, not letting people decide what they want in their state, we ended up with the first and only real movement at secession, again begun by South Carolina, which resulted in the Civil War. So we have in our history an example of secession, and we have an example of the consequences of secession as well. 650,000 died, if I've got the number correct. What was kind of interesting was the way that started, though. Lincoln didn't want to attack the South, and the South didn't want to attack the North, but Lincoln got sneaky, and he said, well, you've taken over some of our ports and harbors and forts, but Fort Sumter, on a little island in the middle of, out from Charleston, was still occupied by the military, and so they said, we're going to resupply it, and the South said no, and so when they went to resupply, the South actually started the war based upon a provocation by the North, and then the North could say the South started the damn war. So a few years later, and all those deaths later, we ended up with the only real life example of secession in the United States, not counting the Revolutionary War, of course, which was a secession as well.
All right. Very, very good. Danny, any thoughts so far?
Not really. Just been listening in. This is all kind of, if you will, news to me, sort of.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I gotcha. So does that? Is there anything else you'd like to say in regards to the Civil War?
Well, I will say in regards to government schools, no wonder it's new to you, Danny. I think there's some things worth consideration too with regard to secession, and I guess it'd just be a good time to bring it up. North Carolina, not South Carolina, in 1787, in a North Carolina Supreme Court decision called Bayard versus Singleton, they addressed the subject matter of secession, which is the constitutional obligation on the government created by the Constitution. And in that decision, now what it was about was, this is after the Revolutionary War, it was before the Constitution, so they were still under the Articles of Confederation. Most of the states, all except two, had developed their own constitution, created their new governments back in 1776 or 77. Rhode Island and Connecticut, I think, were the two that simply adopted the charters and took out any reference to royalty or the British government. But the issue was, now the Treaty of Paris said that that the lands will be returned to the landowners that fled or the ownership at least would return to the owners of land that fled as Tories. And the North Carolina legislature enacted a law that says, no, the Tories have lost their land. Now the North Carolina Constitution had a similar provision for protection of property without, can't be taken without compensation, that we've got in the Bill of Rights in the federal Constitution, but they enacted this law in contradiction to the provision in the their Constitution that prohibited taking land without compensation. So here's what the court said, but that it was clear that to act, that no act they could pass, meaning the legislature, by any means repeal or alter the Constitution, because if they could do this, alter the Constitution without an amendment, they would at the same instant of time destroy their own existence as a legislature and dissolve the government thereby established. Now think about that. It's like a contract. If you breach the contract ceases to exist. And that's what the North Carolina Supreme Court said in Bayard versus Singleton. Now, that was the year of the Constitutional Convention, and the Constitution was then ratified and put in place in 1789. But when we look at secession, as I mentioned before, there was a matter of secession before. Now, a lot of people say that in fact, a discussion on Facebook today, the guy said something I've heard over and over again, and that is, well, the Constitution allows you to secede from the Union, but it's a very difficult process. So I ask him, where in the Constitution and what's the process? And he hasn't gotten back with me, and that was this morning. But we do have an example is rather interesting. Now, some of you will recognize the words, probably not Danny, but we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal, that they are endowed by their creator with certain unalienable rights, that among these are life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, that to secure these rights, governments are instituted among men, deriving their just powers from the consent of the governed, that whenever any form of government becomes destructive of these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it and to institute new government, laying its foundation on such principles and organizing its powers in such form as to them shall be most likely to affect their safety and happiness. Prudence indeed will dictate that governments long established should not be changed for light and transient causes, and accordingly all experience hath shown that mankind are more disposed to suffer while evils are sufferable than to right themselves by abolishing the forms to which they are accustomed. But when a long train of abuses and usurpations pursuing invariably the same object evinces a design to reduce them under absolute despotism, it is their right, it is their duty to throw off such government and to provide for new guards for their future security. Well, that is secession, to throw off that government and create a new one. But they're absolutely right when they say that we tend to accept what we've got now, and we're far worse than we were. I think we need a couple examples. The soldiers that were involved in the Boston Massacre had to stand trial in front of a jury of citizens. So now the sheriff's department, the police department, the federal government, the state government will look at a police shooting and say, well, that was justifiable homicide. And so we've even had removed from us the authority under the Constitution for a grand jury, because that doesn't go to grand jury unless the state decides to give it to it, and the petite jury that should judge whether something is right or wrong. So we have exceeded the point of what I just read to you about the abuses and usurpations. Usurpation is taking authority that's not granted. Abrogation is refusing to do a duty that you're supposed to perform. So we've got abrogations and usurpations evincing a design to put us under absolute despotism. You know, I'm no young man, and when I was a kid, this is a free country. I was born right after World War II, and the 50s and the first half of the 60s were phenomenal as far as freedom and prosperity in this country. The 60s brought on something called the Civil Rights Movement. And the civil rights movement is kind of interesting because a civil right is given by government, but whenever a civil right is granted, it takes away from somebody else. For example, if you have to hire a Negro, you have to fire a white guy to make room for the Negro. So any civil right is going to be a detriment to one and a gain to the other. And so that's the usurpation. The Constitution never made provision for any civil rights to be granted. And so that's one of the usurpations. They have assumed the authority to relinquish our the rights protected by the Constitution and submit them to the state's determination on who should have that right at our expense.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely. We'll get more into the other aspect of this or apply to the Constitution. But so obviously, I guess, was secession legal under the Articles of Confederation, or was there just not a specific provision in there that didn't not allow it, or can you speak to that a little bit?
Well, the Confederation is kind of interesting. It said a perpetual union, but it required a unanimity to make any significant change in what was included in the Articles of Confederation. Now, a lot of people have argued that the perpetual union carried over to the Constitution, which gets kind of curious. Let's see, the Constitution required 9 states to ratify before the new government created by that Constitution would come into existence, leaving 4 states out there in the wilderness, so to speak. Now, that violates this perpetual union concept by just the application of ratification of the Constitution. So can the Constitution be a perpetual union when it removed the perpetuity of the Articles of Confederation, leaving up to four states to hang out to dry? No, there was no, it was not a perpetual union then, because they destroyed the concept of perpetual union from the Articles of Confederation in the creation of the government under the Constitution. So the government's argument that we are a perpetual union and you can't secede, I think, is moot, because they have proven by the creation of that very government that it's not applicable. And they did not repeat the phrase perpetual union as well.
And that's so, I'll turn it back to you in a second. But yeah, when we get into the second segment, I'll actually be reading a quote from a decision, a court decision, and I guess you'll have some thoughts on that. But yeah, go ahead and finish your thoughts.
Well, that's about it. That the idea of perpetuity of the union is not in the Constitution, as many people want to claim. And so now we get into other discussions. For example, what I read from the Declaration of Independence, when that government does deviate, when we get into what Baird versus Singleton said, if the government violates the contract, have they broken the contract? Are we still bound by it? Does that government that was created by that that contract even continue to exist? So now... I think we'll leave it there for now, and we'll get some more pieces to the puzzle and bring everything together a little later.
Yeah, that's an interesting way. It's an interesting way to look at it. So obviously, clearly, the government hasn't held up their end of the contract, and therefore, as you explained earlier, it's moot at that point. I haven't necessarily thought of that angle, but yeah, that's correct. That's correct. Okay.
So, where are we now?
Go ahead.
Well, continuing that thought, the Kentucky resolves were written most likely by Jefferson, and it was a threat at secession that never got past just being written. There was an accommodation to it. We've got... But as far as usurpations, the Alien and Sedition Acts, John Adams didn't like being criticized. And so they enacted the Alien and Sedition Acts. Some of them were probably valid, but some of them really took rights away. So at that point, there was a usurpation of authority that did not exist, to tell people, basically, you lost your right to freedom of speech because you're saying bad things about the government, which is what they did about the British government. At least after the war started, they were very polite until the April 19th, 1775. One other aspect that's rather interesting as far as abrogating the responsibility in the Constitution, there's a state in the Union called West Virginia. And the Constitution... Article 4, Section 3 says, new states, and I mentioned this earlier about Jefferson, new states may be admitted by the Congress into this Union, but no new state shall be formed or erected within the jurisdiction of any other state, nor any state be formed by the junction of two or more states or parts of states without the consent of the legislatures of the states concerned, as well as of the Congress. Now, the Virginia legislature never consented to the creation of West Virginia out of the mountainous region of Virginia. So in 1861, an illegal state was made, and a blatant, that was the first real blatant violation of the Constitution, which is kind of an interesting, when we start looking at usurpation and abrogation of the federal government's responsibilities.
Yeah, and what's we've got about a minute left. What was the response by, I guess, the federal government when West Virginia decided to just outright break the law, so to speak?
Well, they didn't. The federal government encouraged them because they wanted a quorum in Congress to satisfy other provisions of the Congress that might require a two-thirds vote, and they were losing that
So they had a vested interest in it then. Okay, yeah, that actually makes perfect sense. What happened with Britain? Why were they able to secede?
Well, I think first we need to a very quick history of the European Union. In 1958, a little over a decade after the end of World War II, there was a Treaty of Rome that was kind of a cooperative arrangement between some of the European nations. Subsequently, in 1993, was the Maastricht Treaty, which went even further in tying these states together, but there was no union, there was no confederation, there was no, it was just, they were trade agreements, basically. But then in 2007, the Lisbon Treaty was enacted, and when it was incorporated with the other two, what was known as the Treaty on European Union was established by consolidation of the three. So, but the Treaty of Lisbon, since they were talking about making more of a confederation then, the treaty on European Union now, Article 50 says any member state may, Section 1 says any member state may decide to withdraw from the Union in accordance with its own constitutional requirements. Now, Brexit then is authorized by Article 50, Section 1 of the treaty on the on European Union, the TEU. Unlike the Articles of Confederation, the perpetuity, and then we've got this gray area in the United States Constitution. It doesn't say it's perpetual. They forgot to carry that forward. And they did adopt other aspects. For example, the Northwest Ordinance was written prior to the Constitutional Convention, but was adopted by the first Congress. So some things were carried forward, but perpetual union was not. So we're somewhere between the European Union, Brexit, and the Articles of Confederation as far as the country. There are other provisions requiring a two-year period. Within Article 50, basically the five elements of Article 50 talk about what steps have to be taken to remove. But it's totally a right of any member of the European Union to withdraw from the European Union if they feel, if their constitution allows it, and if they feel that the need, which the sore losers in England wanted to redo the vote. We didn't like the way it turned out, but the decision was made, and so it's on its way out. Now the new prime minister wants to delay implementing Article 50 because they've got to work out trade agreements and all that. All of a sudden, you've got a new nation. What's our relationship going to be with the European Union?
I heard this. There are a couple countries in there that aren't a part of the European Union that yet they can still trade with the EU just fine. I don't remember what countries there are, but yeah, I see. So yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, the EU can sign trade agreements just like the United States can try sign trade agreements with other countries. It's when they're consolidated, the United States, the European Union, NAFTA, North American Free Trade Agreement, the TTP, all these things that are consolidating towards the one world government, an oligarchy of the elitists in the world. And so the interesting thing about Brexit is they really kick the elitist in the balls, pardon the expression, because they said, no, we'll not have it. Now, the European Union is run by appointed people, not by elected people. So, and one of the concerns in Brexit was we have no say. Actually, there's something in this country that was enacted back in the, I think it was the 70s, it's called the Tahoe Regional Area Plan. Now, the acronym for that is TRAP, TRAP. And it was between Nevada and California in the Lake Tahoe region, which straddles the border between the two states. And it was non-elected people, appointed people, basically creating a government common to the two states. And so there have been a number of efforts where non-elected people, getting back to royalty, aristocracy, basically, where non-elected people have become in charge of governments to some degree. And I guess the other big draw on Brexit leaving, and I think, you know, Sweden and Germany and some of these others may begin considering it soon, is they have this open border policy. Anybody in the European Union is free to travel to any other state or country and settle, just like we can in this country. Now, the problem is, if one state allows them in, and Germany is notorious for allowing them in, once they're inside the boundaries of the Union, they can go wherever they want, regardless of what their status is. Now, we're seeing the same thing happening in this country right now, whether it be refugees or people coming across the southern border. So, you know, there's a picture here. Events is designed for to put us under absolute despotism. We're seeing that that problematic situation that does force secession with force of arms.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely. And yeah, you did raise a really, really valid concern there. I don't remember specifically these. I don't pay attention to the news cycle much, but I did look through. And some of the stuff that was coming out of the EU that kind of motivated Britain to leave, just the most ridiculous regulations, just the most ridiculous and arbitrary regulations. But so they voted on the referendum. It passed. So what's the next step? Are they out of the European Union, or what are the steps that we can see following that?
Well, the Prime Minister is delayed invoking Article 50. They want to get their ducks in a row first. If she delays too long, I imagine she'll end up unemployed because the move to remove is there. But apparently she thinks it's going to take more than 2 years to resolve trade issues and other aspects that were covered. They've got to go back to the pound and get away from the euro. And I can't see the complexity. We didn't have those complexities when we told England to go back across the ocean. But apparently there are some, and I've not looked into it, but she seems to feel that a lot has to be done before they even invoke Article 50. However, maybe, I don't know, maybe she's trying to get the vote over again and try again. I have no idea.
Yeah, it'll be interesting to watch. And I said a few weeks ago, I don't remember, one is a month or so ago, I would not be surprised at all if there were some really, really twisted shenanigans and Brexit didn't actually happen, because it's not over yet. It's not over yet, unfortunately. So we'll have to see what happens.
Well, I think in England it is, and I think if they could go against the will of the people, and remember the open borders, the Muslims get to vote in England too, and you know. England used to have two tiers of citizenship, and then there were other people excluded from citizenship. And now, like us, anybody can vote, and you don't need a picture ID unless you're going to the Democratic National Convention. Or getting on an airplane.
Yeah.
So, okay. I don't know the complexities, and it'll play out in time, but I'm not really following that. I did during the Brexit vote and shortly thereafter to see where it was going. And when she said there was going to be a delay, you know, I don't know what the shenanigans are, and we'll hear a lot of conversation now, but it'll settle out in time, and at that point, I'll start looking at it again.
Yeah. Okay, very, very good. So we've discussed Brexit now. Let's move here to the United States. Are any states able to legally secede?
Legally secede? There's no provision for secession. There's no provision against secession. There is a provision against insurrection. Now, the interesting thing about insurrection is the Constitution only gives the authority for the militia, the body of the people, to be used to suppress insurrection, not the army, but the body of the people. So if they call forth the militia to suppress insurrection, what if that militia body says, screw you, we want to get out too?
Mm-hmm.
So, but there is, you know, nothing, like I said before, there's nothing in the Constitution that makes it perpetual. There's nothing that prohibits the state from leaving. But using insurrection to do so would be contrary to the Constitution. Now, that's probably why Lincoln needed the South to begin the war.
Mm.
To be as close to the Constitution as he possibly could by being attacked, the United States being attacked by South Carolina, you can call that insurrection. Now he can call forth the militia to suppress the insurrection.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, fair enough, fair enough. Yeah, that makes sense. But, yeah, there was a document you sent me.
There is nothing that prohibits it. There's nothing that authorizes it. There's kind of a gray area in the whole issue of insurrection. What would happen if they voted and gave no handle to the federal government to start a war?
Mm-hmm.
Now, I know when we get to Texas, we'll be kind of addressing that, so let's go on.
Okay. All right. So you sent me a few documents. The first one was an act to admit the states. And I think this was, March 30th, 1870. And the full title.
No. You got to go back to Texas Admission Act, March 1st, 1845. I wrote the 4th on it, but it was March 1st.
Okay.
That's
yep,
where we start.
That works. All right. Let's go for that then. What's significant about that?
Now, it's kind of interesting. There are a number of things that they had to cede to the United States all public edifices, fortifications, barracks, ports, harbors, navy, and navy yards, docks, magazines, arms, armaments, and other property and means pertaining to the public defense belonging to said Republic of Texas. So those had to be turned over to the federal government. They also had to turn over land to the federal government. After certain conditions were met, they had to cede to the United States government the remaining territory to the federal government to be agreed upon by the government of Texas and the United States. And then they gave a lot of money back then, $100,000 to Texas to cover the expense of them coming into statehood. Now, that's the Texas Admission Act of 1845, which Texas was a republic until 1845 after they kicked Santana out. And so they became a member of the Union. Now, there was a provision in there that allowed them to new states of convenient size, not exceeding 4 in number, in addition to the said state of Texas and having sufficient population, could be created. So Texas could have created 4 more states, turned into 5 states. Now, the reason for that, quite simply, is if you get away from the original states, almost all the states in the Union and the westward movement are nearly equal in size. California and Texas, both being republics prior to admission, are larger. Ignore Alaska and Hawaii, but Oregon, Washington, Iowa, Kansas, all these states, if you look at the map, they're fairly close in size. And I think they looked at Texas and said, well, as far as area, you've got enough to make 4 more states out of it. But that was the original Admission Act. There's nothing that says they have the right to secede, as people claim. it's 3 sections. Three sections, and none of them give any rights. Now, and then I could give you another one about questions of answers. And there's a lot of rumors about Texas, you know, the claim that they have the right to secede. It was given to them. Somebody yesterday said, it was a letter. Well, a letter doesn't override an act by Congress accepted by the Texas legislature. It might be somebody's opinion. But the question on Texas annexation, this is off the state of Texas page, and it could be biased. There's no doubt about that. But did the term of Texas' admission to the Union include permission to withdraw if it found statehood not to its liking? And then they go on to explain, no, it's not there, and the rumor's been around for many years. And, you know, it comes back like a nightmare almost, because nobody can prove it. Now, after the Civil War, after they did secede from the Union, they re-entered the Union on March 30th, 1870. Now, understanding admission documents, they have to develop a constitution, they have to have a certain population, That's submitted to Congress. Congress gives it blessing, sends it back to them with conditions. They accept the conditions, and at that point, they become a state. I'm going to throw a little kicker in here just for the hell of it. In 1803, Ohio thought it was a state. It became a state in 1953, 150 years later, because some of this paperwork was not completed on time. But the states that left the Union, with the exception of Tennessee and Kentucky, I think, some of the split states during the Civil War, had to re-enter the Union. And so that occurred in 1870. And there was an oath, two oaths that had to be taken. And if you had taken an oath to the United States and then fought or supported the Civil War, the military forces, you could not hold an office in the state. So you had to take two oaths. One is that you had not, and the other one is that you give your obedience to the United States. They did not repeat the four-state provision, so whether I would say that the readmission in 1870 overwrites. If we wrote a new contract between you and I regarding a business, the new contract supersedes the old contract, and this has no provision for the additional four states. And, you know, it had provisions like you have to let everybody vote and things like that. But there's nothing that gives them any right, carries over any right that didn't exist in the first place. So Texas never had the right to secede in the first place, nor was it reestablished by the document that overrode all previous documents when they reentered the Union.
Yeah. Yeah, definitely, definitely. And let me just say real quick, I know the anarchist libertarians listening are probably a little confused now, but we will, in the third segment, we'll get more into this, and we'll kind of complete the picture here. So hold your horses and then hear us out. Okay, let's see. There was one interesting case, and you mentioned something similar in the previous segment. And I'll give a little background on this one. This was Texas versus White, 74 U.S. 700, 1869. Was a significant case argued before the United States Supreme Court. Case involved a claim by the Reconstruction government of Texas that United States bonds owned by Texas since 1850 had been illegally sold by the Confederate state legislature during the American Civil War. The state filed suit directly with the United States Supreme Court, which under the United States Constitution retains original jurisdiction on certain cases in which a state is a party. So there's just a little background. And there's one quote, and I want to get Gary's thoughts on this, because there was from what he said before, I think there may be an issue with this, but nonetheless, here it is. Quote, "When, therefore, Texas became one of the United States, she entered into an indissoluble relation. All the obligations of perpetual union and all the guarantees of Republican government in the Union attached at once to the state. The act which consummated her admission into the Union was something more than a compact. It was the incorporation of a new member into the political body, and it was final. The union between Texas and the other states was as complete, as perpetual, and as indissoluble as the union between the original states. There was no place for reconsideration or revocation except through revolution or through consent of the states," end quote. So do you think that's a good way of putting it? Do you think there's some issues with that because of the indissoluble union, or what are your thoughts?
Well, I think the mood in 1869, that was the year before readmission, that they had to resolve some problems. Now, in there, he says she entered into an indissoluble relation. And, you know, I don't know where that came from, but when a Supreme Court justice says something, it was majority decision. It wasn't unanimous, but a lot of things are said in cases that you have to consider the times and the context. I don't know where he thinks it's indissoluble, so I object to that. But what they wanted to do is get the decision was to get back as close to the status quo prior to secession. But I think politically he had to say it was indissoluble, because that's what 650,000 lives were thrown into the pit for.
Fair enough. Okay, very good. But I guess observing that and what you kind of mentioned so far, I mean, let me ask you one more question in regards to that. The last sentence in this, do you think this is valid? Quote, there was no place for reconsideration or revocation except through revolution or through consent of the states.
Well, he did say with the consent of the states and perhaps a petition to Congress. You could secede with a petition to Congress, but I don't think Congress will let it go unless you're a worthless state. You know, basically every state has wealth, and they're not going to take a state in an internal state, for example, and make an enclave out of something that's not part of the United States. The coastal states all have, by their very nature of being coastal, have value of shipping and production and everything else that is beneficial to the country. But he did say except through revolution, and now that refers back to the Civil War wasn't a revolution, was it? The Revolutionary War was a revolution. So, you know, he doesn't really close the door. He almost contradicts himself. Huh. Because he says his end is voluble, but then except through revolution or through the consent of the states.
So it's not
two opt-outs. So is it clearly defined by the Texas v. White? I would say no.
Okay. Very good. And yeah, you brought up a good point there. Obviously, they want that income, whether it's taxes or just overall GDP, et cetera. But yeah, I think that
or defense, and obviously the defense of the country primarily, except against air attacks, is going to be the perimeter states.
True. And I don't know if this is. I remembered it was like Texas has like the 9th or 12th largest economy in the world. So yeah, they aren't going to like let that go easily. But we'll get more into that in the next segment. But I want to bring up Article 1, Section 2 of the 1876 Texas Constitution, which says if the Texan people do not enjoy a Republican form of government, then abolition of the Texan government is on the table. Would abolition of a state government, like as per the Texas Constitution, be preferable to an attempt at secession?
Well, you being a quasi-anarchist, you'd say we abolish the government and then there's nothing there. We're going to leave a void there. But I think the presumption, just like there was with the Declaration of Independence, the Articles of Confederation, and eventually the Constitution, there's the presumption that you would reinstitute the state government and that secession from the United States is not a part of that. And to support that contention, quite simply, the Congress approved that Constitution. So obviously the Congress felt that it was not secession by any means. It was just the right of the people of Texas to abolish the Texas government and create a new one in its place that was Republican in its form. However, Republican in its form has kind of lost meaning because I don't have it in front of me, but I think it's Wyoming or Idaho Supreme Court in 1990s decision said that our hands are tied. We cannot enforce our own constitution because of federal or the United States Supreme Court. So the Republican form of government is gone. Kevin Massey's case, state of Texas says you can have a firearm 5 years after the completion of your sentence. Federal government says never. And Massey's in prison right now because the Republican form of government is moot. Now, why do we even have states if they can't pass a law saying you can have a gun 5 years after you complete your sentence?
Yeah.
So the Republican nature, again, back to the usurpations of federal government and the abrogations, they're abrogating Article 4, Section 4, which creates a Republican form of government, and they're usurping authority beyond the borders. It's based on the Commerce Clause, but once it's been in commerce, they say, well, that gun now is illegal. If it hasn't been in commerce, it's not. This is where we're getting back to the Declaration of Independence and the usurpations and the original cause for the revolution. And so do we want to change Texas government or do we want to change the federal government becomes the key question.
Okay, very good. And I want to toss in the, and we'll get to New Hampshire All right, sometime in the last hour, but Article 10 of New Hampshire's state constitution, quote, government being instituted for the common benefit, protection, and security of the whole community and not for the private interest or emoluments of any one man, family, or class of men. Therefore, whenever the ends of government are perverted and public liberty manifestly endangered and all other means of redress are ineffectual, the people may, and of right, ought to reform the old or establish a new government. The doctrine of non-resistance against arbitrary power and oppression is absurd, slavish, and destructive of the good and happiness of mankind. So, there's some interesting things in there in the state constitutions, but I don't know. Do I think the Texans will ever abolish the state government? Probably not, and probably don't expect New Hampshire to use other tactics other than non-violence, things like satyagraha and just get arrested.
Remember, the state constitutions only act within the boundaries of that state, the geographic boundaries of the state. So neither one of them is providing a means or protecting a right for the people to change the government within the boundaries of the state. But that's only within the boundaries of the state. Now, if enough states have that in that, isn't it, even a few states have that in there, isn't a presumption that the same should apply to the federal government?
yes, that's definitely a good point. We're up to the second break. When we come back, we'll get into the potential ramifications, which is one thing I definitely don't think a lot of anarchist libertarians have been looking at.
Let me provide a transition from the last segment to the next segment, if I might.
Please do.
Would abolition of a state government be preferable to an attempt at secession? Let's look at that for just a minute. If you abolished a state government and recreated one and took away the federal strings, what I refer to as green mail, the schools used to be funded by county taxes, ad valorem taxes on property. But then the state jumped in and started participating, and now the federal government almost completely funds the public school system. They control the police departments in Crime Control Act of 1994, for example, there's an article on that on my original page, not the blog page. You give money to the police departments to do things. They give them military equipment. Cities, counties, law enforcement is getting federal funds. City governments are getting federal funds under various programs. Billions of dollars go to the various states. In fact, Kyle had gone and looked at some stuff in Texas to see how many federal dollars were coming there, and the numbers were phenomenal. So let's say we abolish the state government and recreate the state government and oblige it to accept no federal money for anything, not even a dime. Now, that would break the thread of control that comes with the funds. The funds mm-hmm. require certain things, like Common Core, things like that. So if you abolish the government in Texas and established a new government in Texas and a new constitution that prohibited the receipt of even a dime of federal funds, those ties are broken. And in a sense, that would be a form of economic secession from the United States, wouldn't it? And I just want mm-hmm. to throw that question out there because of this discussion we've had. The thought occurs that would be a form of secession without secession because we've broken the ties, the green mail ties between the two.
Very good. I'm really glad you brought that up. But we do have a question from chat from Vote for Nobody, like the name. I like to preface it with this. Committees of safety are something that are on the Freedom Umbrella of Direct Action. We had Gary on for the first edition of the Direct Action series on January 3rd to discuss committees of safety. Definitely go check that out. There's a good reason there on the Freedom Umbrella of Direct Action are still there on the third edition. But Gary, the question in chat is this. Wouldn't forming local committees of safety be a secessionist effort?
Not necessarily. They're foundational. There would not be a United States if it wasn't for committees of safety in the 1770s. No, it's not. It's a parallel government, and its job is to fill in where the government fails, to protect life, liberty, and property, for example. If things get bad enough, though, it becomes a transitional government, which it did in the 1770s, where state committees of safety and the Continental Congress were all evolved from the local committees of safety. So it's a step in the right direction, And it's a way of, if there were enough committees of safety, I think the voice would be recognized, or the people shot, one or the other, that said government back off. We want to go back to the Constitution. And if we, you know, you and I have had the private conversations about if we go back to the Constitution in the first 50, 60 years of this country, we get a completely different picture than what we see today. And most people, their worldview of the United States begins when they're, say, 15 years of age, and they think it's always been like that.
Okay, very, very good. And Danny, go ahead and step in with your question. Just keep it as brief as you can.
All right, Gary. I don't know. Are you familiar with the? There was an article called in the fifth column called "The Cycle of Insurgency." Have you heard of this at all?
No, I haven't. But
all right. So
insurgency is what got us the country.
Yeah. I was discussing this on another show that I'm a host of, and we were discussing how, like, every time there's an insurgency, another government arises out of it. Do you foresee any possibility in which there is an insurgency, at which there isn't a government that arises out of it?
Possible to conceive of that occurring. If you kick out, if the insurgency is successful, it has kicked out the existing government. Now, in all the revolutions that I've looked at, or the insurgencies, successful insurgencies, the only one that had a peaceful transition of government was the United States of America. And again, this lends back to the committees of safety, the provincial committees of safety, and the Continental Congress. We had a government in place. We transitioned from a wartime Articles of Confederation, eventually to the Constitution. So there was no loss, but the Russian Revolution, the French Revolution, you know, to name the more significant ones, even the British Revolution of 1664, if I got the date right, it's a whole new government. You know, everything's thrown out and you start over. That was Cromwell. So there is one exception to that, and that is this country.
Well, what I mean is, like, we've had an the United States had an insurgency, and then we had the Articles of Confederation, and then we moved over to the Constitution. But what I'm really gathering at is, do you think it's possible to have an insurgency, and then everyone just sits there and says, okay, this system doesn't work, government doesn't work, we need to stop trying to institute this system that keeps consistently failing?
Well, I wrote an article called The Plan for Restoration of Constitutional Government. It's rather lengthy. It's 10 parts that I think in 6 or 7 years could restore the original intent as written and intended by the founders. But the other revolutions, the most powerful element surviving the insurrection becomes the government. That was not the case here because there wasn't a competition between different power groups. So, you know, it defies the norm on insurrection as far as a new government, because that government was actually begun before the war began. Committees of safety sent their militia to Lexington and Concord, for example. They acted as a parallel government, and they saw the need. The militias had subordinated to the committees of safety rather than the royal governor. So, you know, there was a government in place all the time. And I don't know if that answers your question, but to me, you know, it was something the world had never seen before or since.
Yeah. Okay. And Danny, we do need to move on here, but if we have time at the end of the segment, I'll let you address your second question. All right. So we've discussed obviously the legality of secession, some examples of it, the history. So what are the, like let's say Texas decides this, like it's actually going forward, like it's gone through the legislature. We'll look at the process in the next segment, but it's gone through the legislature. The people have voted on it. The Texans have voted on it, and it's going to happen. What are the potential ramifications of that?
Well, the most significant one is the same one that began the fighting in the Civil War. According to, I think, Kyle's research, there are 31 total military installations in Texas. That includes two Coast Guard, 10 smaller Coast Guard stations, 11 Army stations, 7 Air Force bases. Now, if Texas said, okay, you can, we'll treat it like Berlin. We'll even let you drive down the interstate, but don't get on gas or anything else to get to these enclave, federal enclaves there. You would take away their ability to force you to move into insurrection. They would be the bad guy if they attacked you at that point. The mistake of Sumter. What would have happened if we had not attacked Fort Sumter? We the South had not attacked Fort Sumter. Would there have been a civil war? I don't know. You know, we can't answer that in hindsight. But if their only claim was to these federal lands, these federal enclaves that had been ceded by the state, now that might include a lot of raw land that was, according to the first Admission Act, that went to the federal government. So the federal government would have a degree of ownership of land in Texas, but if there was no belligerence related to that, who's going to, non-aggression principle, who's going to throw the first punch? And if the United States government does, then that's going to outrage the rest of the country.
Unless
there's going to be the politics, and the politics preceded the Civil War. There was a peace commission. The South was trying to resolve problems with the federal government, trying to find an amicable separation, but the federal government didn't want it. And I imagine that belligerence on the part of the federal government would exist now. Could the politicians in Texas manage to keep the upper hand in that to show that we're not being belligerent, we're just saying goodbye?
I think the reality of it, I just cannot see, especially with it being one like 12th largest economy, whatever the number is, it's a big economy in Texas, and with all the military installations, I just can't see it. The federal government is saying, okay, all right, yeah, that's fine, see you guys. I just can't see it. That doesn't seem realistic to me at all.
A lot of that commerce is goods shipped from internal states through Texas ports too.
Exactly.
And that would stop unless a trade agreement came up. You know, is there a political solution that could be had? It depends on the willingness of both sides to have an amicable separation. Because by trade agreements, the United States could still share some of the benefits of that economy.
Yeah. Yeah, that is true. That is true. But I mean, do you think? Do you think it's possible that it could turn violent?
That possibility. If again, back to the Civil War, the Peace Commission, they were trying desperately. The South was trying desperately. They weren't willing to make concessions. The North was willing to make some concessions, but they couldn't come to a meeting of the minds. And. We're projecting the future. It is possible that it could be peaceful. It is possible. I think the greater likelihood would probably that it would turn violent. Now, the interesting part, though, is if enough other states wanted to secede from the Union at the same time, even if they were not adjacent to Texas, if Louisiana and New Mexico stayed in, and the internal states are probably going to stay in. It's the exterior state, because that becomes problematic when you have an enclave in the center. You've got the chokehold on them, because the United States says, okay, you can't cross this border without our consent, so you can't take food or supplies or materials in there. You're going to fly over U.S. airspace, which didn't exist back then, to fly goods in like we did in the Berlin airlift. So it becomes problematic. But if California and Oregon and Washington and Arizona and maybe New Mexico decided to, or even South Carolina again, or any of those states, if there was enough perimeter area of the seceding states to be problematic for the government, that would be a bargaining chip. There's no doubt about that. If it's just one state, ain't too much on the bargaining table. The more that we're playing the game, the greater the bargaining chip.
Yeah, yeah. Okay, very, very, yeah, very, very good, very good. So
that's
so
all
I guess,
hypothetical, though. Just let's be clear about that.
Oh, yeah, of course, of course. Yeah, so I guess, Danny, if you want to ask that question or propose a different one now, yeah, go for it. We've got a little bit of time here.
No, well, the two questions were kind of in and of the same. The discussion that we had on the roundtable was like, you know, if there is an insurrection, how can we go about supposedly having an insurrection and then not having, like, taking history's lessons about how an insurgency could work and then applying it nowadays, and then after the insurgency is done, there is no central authority that emerges out of that. Like, the idea is really, how do we get away from any type of governing body?
Well, I can't help you there, because I can't imagine anything existing for any period of time without some governmental body. The whole issue comes down to, as it did with the Constitution, especially under Jeffersonianism, how limited is the government's authority? What is necessary for them to exist? And that's where, for those first 60 years, we were close to that. They didn't meddle in the states. But the plan for, you know, I don't know if you've read it, Danny, but I think Shane has, and I know Sleepy Kyle has, the plan for restoration of constitutional government. I think the Constitution's a fine starting point for a government with limitations, but there's got to be some way to challenge the usurpations without violence. And that needs, so the Constitution needs to be amended to give the people political safeguards against usurpation of the federal government. And that is non-existent. They assumed that voting every 2 years for representative, every six for senators, and every four for president, that the people's memory was long enough to say, these are scumbags, let's not put them back in office. But what has come down to, and this is back to dollars, a senator that brings in billions of dollars into your state, come campaign time, I brought $30 billion to our state last round. Oh, he brought all that money in the state, I'm going to vote for him. So it's become kind of an economic situation that has also become an intolerable situation. So if the Constitution were amended to tie the hands of government to and to leave, not through election process, but through legal process, a way of curtailing their stepping outside their boundaries, then you got a functioning government. And then each state then would have the autonomy that it needs as a republican form of government to do what it sees fit. And so now the state government could get even more restrictive as far as the authority of the state government. So you could approach anarchy, but you would still have the elements that are, you know, defense, commerce, things like that, that are probably necessary.
Okay, very, very, very good, very good. But I wanted to kind of bring this up, and I'll mention it more here in the final segment. But so there's obviously a chance of violence when it comes to secession, and this is one reason why I think libertarians and anarchists haven't really thought about it that deeply, because I mean and we talked about this last week with Kyle Reardon, but libertarians and anarchists don't really like talking about use of force issues. And Gary, one thing I really do respect about the Patriots is the fact that it's a subject often discussed. And even, I mean, with the civil defiance and things of that nature, it's even actionable. So I like that. I really like that. But when it comes to, the furthest libertarians and anarchists have gone is like peaceful parenting for the most part, which that's not anything really significant in my opinion. But they don't like, the Free State Project has booted out Cantwell and Larkin Rose got in some trouble. When they talked about just the right to self-defense and shoot it, when should you shoot a cop? And to think that like New Hampshire could be discussing secession when they are just so scared to even talk about hypothetically within Brandenburg v. Ohio within the limitations Supreme Court court precedent, I don't see that as being realistic at all. And and I think there's definitely a major issue there. If you can't even hypothetically talk about use of force issues like we've done on LUA radio for, I guess, probably the past week and a half, how are you going to, like, if Texas secedes and you have to actually start shooting government agents, how the hell are you going to do that? You know, Gary?
Well, first about New Hampshire, I'm sure that on their webpage they have a click here to donate button because, you know, it's unrealistic to think that New Hampshire would be in a position to secede from the Union. Use of force, the non-aggression principle gets rather interesting, and, you know, you and I spoke of some aspects of it a few days ago, but... Now, putting into perspective to what we're talking about, if my property is threatened because of ridiculous taxation that I can't afford and they're going to take my land, at what point do I have a right to defend my property when I know, or at least I believe, the intention is to take my property away? Now, this is interesting because in the Hammond case in Oregon, Dwight Hammond back in the 80s even said, "You're trying to take my ranch from me." Does he have is that the point that I can become aggressive in defense of my property? And so in terms of a broader picture, not the individual picture, but say secession, at what point can you assume that there's going to be aggression and retaliate with counter-aggression even before the aggression on the other side begins?
And that's a good question. And for me, and maybe and some other folks as well, but there's been a little, especially after the Dallas cop shooting happened, when a few of the cops died, this was a major debate point. And for me, I mean, it's like a threatening person and property, and that includes fraud. So obviously theft. Which would be taxation, that would be a violation of person and property. So I believe that it is moral, but strategically, you got to think about strategically too, which is where I do agree with the limited use of force discussion that was happening in the libertarian community. It's not good strategically. Those cops being shot isn't going to reduce the state or anything of that nature. It's going to, and actually as I saw an article, and there was a police protection act or something passed in one state, so they're just protecting the police extortionists more. So yeah, there's the moral aspect and there's the strategical aspect. Now if the Hamas decided to start shooting government agents when they came and took their land, they'd be in an even worse position than they're in now. So hopefully that clarifies some things. I mean, it's a good discussion point.
Well, let's take the secession just one thought further. Mm-hmm. Texas is going to secede. So the United States says you're taking part of our country. You're stealing part of our country. Does that justify aggression? Texas, on the other hand, says you're going to try and steal back from us what rightfully belongs to us. Does that justify the use of aggression then to preemptively, in both cases, preemptively protect what is ours, whether you be the United States government or the Texan secessionists?
It's a good question too. Well, with both, we're dealing with governments, and one of their funding mechanisms is taxation. So there is an infringement on person and property in both of those instances, unless someone's tax exempt for some reason due to legal interstice or something.
Okay, let's say Texas you live in Illinois. If Illinois decided to secede, would you push the donate here button or not? Voluntary taxation to support the movement.
Enough of the money I've earned has gone to the state of Illinois. I wouldn't voluntarily donate to government. Hell no. No, that gets back to the same thing. Whenever we Kyle Reed and I discussed the United Police States of America and went through all the funding mechanisms, even with all the taxation now, people still voluntarily donate to police departments. No, I'll never voluntarily donate to a government. Now, if it's like, I don't know, like, I don't like the word, but we use that revolution tomorrow, and I don't know, there was a government, and they said, we aren't going to tax you. All you have to do is voluntarily contribute. I still wouldn't volunteer. I probably wouldn't donate, but I would be okay with that because it's a voluntary contribution. It's no different than donating to like the Red Cross or something at that point.
Well, what if they wanted your body to get on the front line and fight for this, the objective, the principle?
Fight for the objective. It depends on the variables at play. Like, I don't know if Illinois was just seceding. I don't know. I don't know. That's a good question. If it were to greatly benefit my life, which I don't think that's possible here in the communist state of Illinois, it's pretty terrible, which is why I use that derisive term. I don't know. It just depends. It just depends. That's what comes down, hypotheticals and on the spot. And we are about out of time. So, Gary, any closing thoughts for the listener on the subject of secession? Do you think it's a good idea and something that people should advocate for?
I think that it requires very serious contemplation of the consequences. Mm-hmm. And for two reasons. One is to recognize what they are, and the other one is to mentally fortify yourself to take on the objective that you're pursuing.
Exactly. Yes, that is very true, and I agree 100%. And that's kind of the point of this broadcast is to get for the libertarians and anarchists that are promoting this to actually realistically look at this and look at all of the possibilities. So, Gary, thank you so much for joining us. You can find his blog at outpost-of-freedom.com/blog. And thank you so much, Gary. You have a great rest of your evening, sir. All right.
Thanks for having me on, and enjoy the rest of the show. I'll be listening.
If you're just joining us, we just got off the line with Gary Hunt, and we were discussing the legal arguments against secession and also the potential ramifications, which I think have been overlooked and not necessarily thought of as much as it really should be, considering the potential deadly ramifications. I think he said 650,000 in and one of the secession movements. You'll have to go back and listen. I don't remember the details. But, yeah, it's a very, very real possibility that there will be violence from the federal government onto the citizens of these states. So, Danny, welcome back. I guess real briefly, and then I'll go on my 10, 15-minute little overview here. What were your thoughts on the interview with Gary on the subject, and also your thoughts on just secession in general?
I liked listening to Gary talk. It was highly informative. Some of it I was kind of aware of it, and some of it I wasn't. Obviously, public school education is a wonderful thing. I guess for me it was just the question at the end. Like, it seemed to me, and maybe I'm misinterpreting it, I'll just throw that out there. It seemed to me he was kind of advocating this, that if we could get back to the Constitution. And I've heard this argument a lot, but as far as I can tell, and I tend to agree with this notion, the Constitution has either done everything to provide this type of government, or it has failed miserably to protect us from this type of government.
Oh, yeah, you're paraphrasing Spooner, yeah. Yeah, the conclusion to no treason, yeah.
So I think trying to go back to it is kind of a pointless task, because even at the end of the day, if you could go back to it and restart it, the amount of abuse that people have done to it, and what I mean is like the general welfare clause. Yes, sorry, that's been misused so heavily that it's used to justify pretty much any type of behavior that is horrific. And you're never going to get people to agree on what that term means. So what's even, like, the Constitution, it seems to me, you would need something is something so specific, so technical in detail, that no one would actually read it or bother to read it. That's what I think it means when I hear saying, oh, we need to revert back to the Constitution. We need to make it so specific it has to be like an engineering document for software.
And you mentioned something important there. I mean, yeah, the Constitution is, I mean, centrally planned. I mean, that and also, I mean, And this is one of the things that kind of brought me around to, like, yeah, you know, I don't know if I believe in government at all. And this is probably a year ago, but every single government throughout history has become tyrannical. Including this one. I mean, you look at the democide statistics, 262 million in the 20th century alone. There's no way in hell. And I put this in a recent article for the Odyssey. There's no way in hell individuals or even a group without the taxation mechanism and the fascism that they could. There's no way that they could actually inflict that much damage. There's no way in hell that only comes with government and those mechanisms. But what I want to do now, Danny, is I want to provide. I've got arguments, and I want to make them and hopefully back them up. So just stand by for just a little bit. I'll run through these, then we'll open up for discussion. I'd like to get your thoughts on this too, because I don't know if anyone else is actually bringing this up from an anarchist perspective. So we'll have to see. All right. So I guess just generally with secession, in regards to shrinking the size of government, I can't say it's a bad idea. Obviously, you're removing the federal level, but that's excluding all that has been mentioned so far, and what I'll kind of go into in this segment. When I first started thinking about it in depth, it was after Brexit, and I was like, well, wow, a lot of anarchists are promoting this. I don't know why. I sat down and thought about it, and these were the initial concerns I had with it. So number one, there would have to be a referendum voting in order to make it happen. I mean, let's ignore the varying procedural laws for now. I'm going state by state. And considering LUA stands on voting as aggression and inconsistent with the twin axioms, the non-aggression principle and self-ownership, this one is kind of obvious, and we beat a dead horse with this one, so I won't spend any more time on that. Number two, it would still be tyranny of the majority. What about the 49% that don't want to exit? It's still an attempt at forcing freedom. So, just like what happened in Britain, that was like 51% yes, 49% no. Well, they're just screwed. They're screwed, unless there's some sort of a redress for them, some way to remedy that. Yeah, they're screwed. They're definitely screwed. Number three, as we discussed on Thursday, and also some tonight, libertarians and anarchists don't even like discussing use of force issues. For the most part, I think peaceful parenting is kind of the exception, and the few that go into killing government agents and such, like Larkin, Rose, and Cantwell, and LUA Radio. But advocating for secession shows that they really haven't thought this through. What is going to be the ramifications put upon the states if they do decide to go through with this? But I'll repeat this again. If they don't even want to talk about shooting government agents in the abstract, especially cops, how the hell are they going to shoot feds when they attempt to stop them from seceding? I think that's a really, really important question to ask. I really do. So, yeah, and as we mentioned in the last segment, the feds would likely crush any attempt at secession, largely because of the amount of federal military bases, unless, as Gary mentioned, that there was some sort of a peaceful way to resolve that. But I'm not very positive about that. I'm really not. This is another reason why it's great to talk about use of force issues publicly before any advocacy for methods occurs. Not only does it help strategically and actually putting together a plan, a rough draft, so to speak, but it can also prevent bloodshed. If you go into something blind, if you don't know your enemy's tactics and you haven't considered the moves that they're going to make, you're going to have a hard time beating them. And it's probably not going to be successful, and a lot of innocent people will die. So I think the next couple of questions to ask, the first one being the more important, would secession violate the non-aggression principle? And the second one, who makes the decision to secede? And we've kind of used Texas as an example here for the show and for good reason. It's one of the most popular. It's got a colored history of secessionist movements. And also it's one of the more prominent ones. So we use Texas as an example here. So Article 1, Section 2 of the Texas Constitution says, quote, all political power is inherent in the people, and all free governments are founded on their authority and instituted for their benefits. The faith of the people of Texas stands pledged to the preservation of a republican form of government, and subject to this limitation only, they have at all times the inalienable right to alter, reform, or abolish their government in such a manner as they may think expedient, end quote. That alone raises an interesting question, though, right? In regards to the constitutionality of secession. It mentions alter, reform. I mean, we know what reformism is, or abolish. And abolish is pretty clear too. But what does alter mean? What does alter mean? I don't know if there's been a legal definition put forth for that. Wasn't able to find one. But I mean, maybe they can secede based off that. But I wouldn't say it's very likely that was the intent of the language when it was used. So that said, it would probably go to the amendment process in Texas at that time, which is Article 17 of the Texas Constitution. So here's the process. So the legislature proposes amendments to the Constitution to be approved by 2/3 of the House and the Senate. It is then voted on by Texans. So it goes to the legislature, and then it's opened up for a vote to the citizens of Texas. And if it passes, the governor announces that it becomes part of the Constitution and another amendment. So this arises some concerns for me, and it should for you too. It should for you too. This is just like state nullification. It requires grassroots lobbying, voters, political rulers, etc. They have to get folks in the legislature who are in favor of secession to actually get the ball rolling. And then the Texans have to rely on irrational voters to vote for it to pass. So yeah, it requires reformism. Which is one reason I don't see it happening anytime soon. Kyle wrote a very good anthology on the subject, Reformism Does Not Work, An Elusive Phantom of Hope, A Critique of Reformism. It's available on the LUA website on the Anthologies tab. And, yeah, I don't have faith in reformism, therefore I can't have faith in the idea of secession. I think it's pretty much just all talk. And, yeah, this isn't even counting the potential ramifications. So even if this were to pass, I mean, yeah, the hammer from the federal government might potentially come down. Okay, so to summarize briefly, as we stated earlier, alter could mean secession. It's the only way it could possibly work. Next, the amendment process would likely come into effect because it's a substantive change as to how the government would be run. They wouldn't be able to rely on green mail anymore, which is federal funding. There'd be a lot of things that would change, which, in my opinion, would probably require the amendment process. So what this means is that the legislature would have to propose it. It would have to pass with 2/3 vote in the House and Senate, and then the fine citizens of Texas be able to vote on it. And again, if it was passed, it'd become part of the Constitution. So I want to speak to green mail here, which, again, is the giving of federal money to states in return for favors. And I think Gary actually came up with that, actually coined that term and was one of the first to write about it. But wars are expensive, and the Texan government probably relies pretty heavily on federal government and on federal funding. So to put things into perspective, the Texas government was actually in a position to kick out the TSA in 2011. And you know what the feds did? They threatened them with an air embargo. And the legislature caved, and the TSA remained in Texas. That's just one small example, but not even close to the scale of a potential secession. There's no background in the legislature. Yeah, secession's a lot bigger of a deal than just the TSA. So I'd like to mention New Hampshire briefly here, NH exit, as it's coined now. Recall in 2013 the ostracism and censorship of Christopher Cantwell by the Free State Project. It was in regards to his article titled Concord Police, Go and Get Your Bearcats. Within he writes, quote, "The government doesn't much care if you are peaceful or not. All they care about is if you are obedient. Free Staters are not being labeled as terrorists because they are violent. They are being labeled as terrorists because they are disobedient. Deep down, Free Staters know this, and that's why they're Free Staters. They see this injustice. They want to stop it. They want it to stop. And so they are coming together to make a stand against it. The only problem is, now that they have come together, they have absolutely no idea what to do, because their vision of a peaceful evolution to a voluntary society is being shattered on an almost daily basis by government violence. That violence is all too sure to escalate as the government agents of New Hampshire and elsewhere acquire more advanced and sophisticated technology to oppress these peaceful activists and the population in general. So what to do?" It's a terribly unpopular thing to say, but the answer, at some point, is to kill government agents. The government agents know that, and that's why they want to tank. End quote. So again, if they won't even allow him to write a freaking blog post within Brandenburg v. Ohio, the Free State Project, I mean, they won't even let him write, discuss the idea in the abstract. I don't even understand why secession is being discussed in New Hampshire. It's not going to happen. It's unlikely. I don't think it's plausible for any of the states, but for New Hampshire specifically, not a chance. Not a chance in hell. So the answer to the previous question, I think it's easy to see that secession is a violation of the non-aggression principle, mainly due to its reliance on voting, and also its start in the legislature. Another point is the tyranny of the majority. If a majority of Texans vote for secession, the minority gets dragged along. Don't the majority of anarchists dislike democracy? I'm pretty sure Hans Hermann Hoppe wrote a book on that, The God That Failed, Democracy, The God That Failed. Yeah, it's not very popular in anarchist circles, at least in propertarian anarchist circles, maybe in the syndicalist communes, but whatever, we're not talking about them. There's also the issue that a lot of anarchists hear from statists. And this one, if I did think this was going to happen, this is probably one that would worry me the most. I feel like we hear some anarchists promote the same non-arguments. If you don't like America, or if you don't like America, then leave. I think it'd be used directly. Like, well, if you don't want to be a part of the independent Republic of Texas, then you can leave. I don't think that's out of the question. I really don't. That's one concern. It's definitely one concern. So I guess to conclude that, and then Danny and I will discuss this. I don't think this is a good idea, and anarchist libertarians should really reconsider their support of secession. At the very least, and this is all that I ask. Give it more thought and consider the ramifications. Because I really haven't seen anything but just memes and comparing Texas to Brexit, which it's a completely different thing. Well, Brexit did it. We can do it now. No, not really. You're talking about two completely geographical locations with different constitutions and such. So, Danny, with that said, what do you think? What do you think about what I've had to say?
Well, two things come to mind. There is the emotional side of me that would like to see more secession, but I agree with you that logically it doesn't make sense if you're voting. What I think is necessary, I don't know if it's necessary or it's more of a point. It would be nice to see more people take like individual secession from the state and coming to the conclusion that they can have voluntary interactions amongst themselves.
That was a good way of putting it. Individual secession would be strategic withdrawal. Very good. Go ahead.
Yeah. I would like to see that. I'm a little caught up because when I think secession, I think of like people saying, okay, this is what we want. We want out of this. But I also agree with you that majority tyranny is a problem. I would like to think that if Texas, for example, feels like they need to secede, that maybe it will inspire them. At least at an individual level. I'm not hopeful that it will, but I would hope that it kind of inspires them to sit there and say, okay, so what is my relationship to the Texan government? Again, I'm not, that's the best I can give it. That's the most optimal situation I can think of, or optimal, I guess, argument, which isn't much of an argument.
That's a good point too, because I mean, like if the Texas, examining their relationship with the state, but I feel like things would get better. They would get better, and I feel like they would begin to fall into complacency again, and that's definitely an issue. Secession doesn't resolve the problem of statism. It doesn't. Now, maybe it's a good pragmatic approach. But they're not saying, you know, we don't need government. Let's secede, and then we can work on the federal government. I don't think that's what's being propagated. I think mostly it's just Texans don't like the federal government for whatever reason. But and that's been pretty blatant. So it doesn't solve the problem of statism. And I mean, there's still going to be the notion that well, government's necessary, but just the Texan government. Right. And yeah, I just don't see it as I just don't like the idea. I don't like the idea, and it's an unpopular opinion to have. But I mean, there's other ways, guys. We did an entire series on it, the direct action series. Yeah. And there's also the Freedom Umbrella of Direct Action. The third edition was released, as I mentioned in the beginning of the show. I mean, there's so many things you can do individually to find freedom in your own life, rather than, and let's bring up state nullification again. I mean, they've been doing that for a while, and I haven't seen any success. This is much like state nullification. That you have to, like if the Texans want secession to happen, they have to be in it for the long haul. They have to get all of the right people into the legislature to actually propose this to begin with. So this is again, it's waiting for the state. You're waiting for permission to be free, which is such a ridiculous statement, but I think it's accurate. So yeah, I don't like this. I definitely don't like this idea.
No, and when we were trying not to, you know, play the roundtable too much on your show, but it's funny because it lined up. This discussion is lining up very much with what we were discussing last week with Daniel Quillen. If you're familiar with him on Facebook, he's a hairy bastard that wears a kilt. anyway. We were discussing, you know, how do we escape this system? How do we get out of it? And the only thing that it seems to kind of conclude with is outright insurrection. I'm not sure if that's a viable option, because the moment that there's insurgency, as you mentioned earlier, the government comes in with a heavy hammer, and, you know, either they're very successful in it and they quell it, or it becomes such a public outrage that everyone starts fighting back. The government has, you know, more or less a meltdown. And then now you're faced with the task of, okay, so now what do we do? How do we organize society all over again?
Yeah. How do we prevent this from happening again? Yeah, I think you. Yeah, that's definitely been an issue, which is why, I mean, I think Molyneux said this. I think this is before he went all kooky, but yeah, if we were to just reset the clock, we'd be back in the same position, because the government doesn't produce anything of value, doesn't produce any wealth, it robs it from the free market, and that I think that's symptomatic in every single government, no matter what structure, what paper cage it's surrounded by. And that's why I don't like the idea of let's just overthrow the federal government now, because there will inevitably be another government. What I think needs to happen now, on top of creating the freedom we desire in our own life, off of the FUTA, I think like what Larkin Rose is doing is really, really good. Going at it from the psychological standpoint, using the Socratic method is important too, and trying to, I guess, I don't like the word convert, but present the information to these individuals, and hopefully they see the flaws in their thinking, and actually bring it to a logical conclusion. So I think that needs to happen. And I'm kind of with Rayo, the guy who wrote Bonnie the Search for Personal Freedom, on this. I mean, the voluntary society in Capistan that we would all like to see come into fruition, or at least us, you know, as anarchists. That is kind of a utopia. It kind of is, especially when considering the fact that governments always existed throughout history. So I think before there's any attempt to overthrow the government, I definitely think there needs to be the winning hearts and minds. I think the work Larkin Rose has done in bringing in people to this line of thinking has been tremendous. And I think that needs to continue, but I also think that we can't get stuck in this mindset that, well, all we have to do is spread, is win hearts and minds, the philosophy of it, present the philosophy to people. That's important, but it's also not good to waste your life away waiting for freedom. There are plenty of options in finding that now, and secession is just another one of those things where, you know, just go vote every 2 years, 6 years, whatever it is, every 2 or 6 years, vote in that senator or the senator or the other guy, and just hope that you can get enough people in there for secession. I mean, you're not guaranteed to win anyways. It's not guaranteed to happen. So you're going to be coming across a lot of opportunity costs. And I just don't see it as valid, valuable, and I don't see it as philosophically consistent with voluntarism or just black flag anarchism more generally.
Well, let me ask you, and this is kind of like devil's advocate for a moment.
Yeah, go for it.
Suppose Texas does leave, okay, and suddenly all the federal bureaucracy goes away in Texas. Would you have an incentive to move out there?
I have considered strategic relocation, but unfortunately, just I've been very, very lucky. But just with the things I'm kind of the things that I enjoy, where I want to be, is in Southern Illinois, down at our property. That's kind of got me locked in around the Midwest. So would I move down there? I don't know. It would be, if it was drastically better, maybe. But I've still got a number of ties here. Everyone that I like, my family and the few friends I associate with, they're all here. And I really don't feel like starting over. And plus, I'm going to be moving down to Southern Illinois at our property in a couple of years after I graduate from high level indoctrination. So, there's that too.
Well, I would sit there. Again, devil's advocate, you can see the people who left communist Cuba, communist Russia, and even the East and West Germanies. They all fled to what they perceived as better opportunity and perceived freedom. So I think there's something to be said about the actual practical implications if there is a perceived freedom, even if there is a lot of statism. I'm all for less of it. I'm all for none of it, but less of it is better than more of it. And I guess to me, it's just more of that pragmatic side kind of emerging. Like, if I can build a business here and it's cheaper, and I can build a life here and it's cheaper and it's better and it's more fantastical, you know what? I can't stay here.
Yeah, I know what you mean, and I'm obviously not for people. Like, if it were to happen, like, I wouldn't knock anyone. I mean, that's freedom of movement. You can go wherever the hell you want to. Quality. We only have one life to live, and if the quality of life somewhere else is going to be better for whatever reason, I don't look down on anyone that does that. You've got to make the best of the situation at hand, and I think that's you're certainly correct.
Get up off